Shane O'Mara is my name, and I'm the chair of the Labour Party in Cork South Central. Tonight's event will explore the definition of family in Ireland, and we are delighted to be joined by three experts in this area, Professor Louise Crowley, Karen Kiernan, and Ivana Bacik. They bring academic, practical, and legislative perspectives and a wealth of experience at the highest policy, NGO, and state levels. The issue of concern is that Ireland has a family problem that many do not know about. In Ireland, the only legally recognised family is that created through marriage. Any other grouping of people who are mutually supportive or dependent, who may be living together, related or not, are simply not considered a family in Irish law. The list of those currently not recognised as families includes cohabiting couples with or without children, siblings or other combinations of relatives, stepchildren who were not adopted before turning 18 and their stepparents, formerly foster children who are now adults and may have strong ties to their foster families, friends who are unmarried and play a significant part in each other's lives, etc. Tonight's discussion is part of a process where members of Labour in Cork South Central have spent the last 2 years exploring the issues relating to how family is defined in Ireland and how change can be brought about. Particular credit is due to Paul Farrelly, who researched this topic as part of his BL and LLM and brought it to our constituency council. Our aim is that the Labour Party will campaign to expand the definition of the family to include groups outside marriage. So we propose utilising the UN definition of the family 1994, which describes any combination of two or more persons who are bound together by ties of mutual consent, birth and or adoption or placement, and who together assume responsibility for, inter alia, the care and maintenance of group members, the addition of new members through process of procreation or adoption, the socialisation of children and the social control of members. If this or any other definition is used, we believe that there will have to be a system or mechanism to facilitate the registration of eligible families to become what we currently term a state registered family. Over the past 18 months, we had meetings with Jack O'Connor, party chair, Alan Kelly, party leader, the national executive, and the support and encouragement of Ivana Bacik, Brendan Howland, TDs, and Billy Sparks, general secretary. In the past year, we've brought motions to the Conference of Labour Women, Youth Equality and LGBT, where it has passed. On the 13th of November this year, we will bring our motion to the National Conference of the Party, a key step in having it officially adopted as party policy. And in all our meetings and engagements, we've had extremely positive and encouraging reactions to our proposal. However, we are very aware that while the proposal may have merit, it requires scrutiny and the benefit of expert critique and perspectives. And we hope today will be part of a process of exploration and development to the benefit of bringing recognition to families outside of marriage. So when myself, Paul Farrelly and Ciara Kennedy were arranging this event with a wish list of three names of possible speakers because of their years of work in the area of family. So Professor Crowley, Karen and Ivana. And we thought if we could get even one of them, that would be great. Two would be fantastic. And so we were ecstatic when the three were confirmed. So each will offer their thoughts on the topic and we'll then engage in discussion and questions from our viewers. So we start with Professor Louise Crowley. So Professor Crowley is a solicitor, a senior lecturer in family law at the School of Law UCC, and author and contributor to a large number of key books and journal articles that are accepted as key texts and essential reading in family law and regulatory approaches to marital breakdown, asset distribution, and marital agreements. Professor Crowley is a member of the European Expert Group on Prenuptial, the National Expert Group on Prenuptial Agreements, appointed by the then Minister for Justice, Equality and Law Reform. In 2010, she was jointly awarded the UCC President's Award for Excellence in Teaching. Professor Crowley is a director of the LLM, Children, Rights and Family Law, and practitioner courses in the School of Law UCC. With students of the LLM, Louise has developed and maintained an online information hub relating to all aspects of family law. Her research in the area of domestic violence law has involved work with Move Ireland and the participants of its perpetrator programmes. Professor Crowley recently developed and introduced the Bystander Intervention Programme to UCC in 2016, recognised as an innovative and effective approach to empowering students to challenge the normalisation of sexual harassment and assault, empowering them to act as pro-social contributors to a safer campus. And Professor Crowley was a member of the expert group appointed by the Minister for Higher Education to develop a framework to end sexual violence and harassment in third level institutions, and she is a member of the governing body of University College Cork. So my hardest job tonight was trying to condense all of her achievements. It's incredible. So Louise, if I might hand over to yourself, you might give us your thoughts if you don't mind.
Thanks, Shane, and thanks so much for the invitation this evening. It's great to have a platform like this to be able to engage in this really important topic. I won't waste any of my 15 minutes, but what I want to say is that this issue I am so passionate about, and my students will tell you that if I can cover much in 15 minutes, I'll be doing well compared to the hours we spend both at undergraduate and master's level debating the huge obstacle that Article 41 in its current format places in Irish society, and that it really is a shameful failure to recognise and respect those who live amongst us and who make choices, use their agency to live and bring up their families in the way that they see best, and yet our constitution excludes them from constitutional status. So what I would say is that any family not a married family does not have constitutional status. So I have a presentation that I will speak to I need to press one second, I'll share screen. This is where you notice there was nothing about technology in my bio, because that's where I do not have expertise. Now, I also think that the slideshow won't maximize for the screen, but I'm hoping people can see predominantly the main screen. Is that good?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, so what I want to do, I suppose, in my 15 minutes is my main job was to provide legal context for the debate. So I will go through fundamentally what the Constitution says and how that has been interpreted by our courts to mean that it cannot be extended to non-marital families. In light of that, I will also show how the legislature has attempted to sidestep but not go through the Constitution, because it simply can't. And so it has made some efforts to give both status and protection to families other than those based on marriage. But there is a hierarchy. They will not have constitutional status. They're legislatively protected and recognised, but not constitutionally. And finally, I want to just very briefly look at reform possibilities, some murmurings in our higher courts at the moment, and also the recent proposal of the Citizens Assembly for reform of Article 41. I'm conscious that Ivana will be looking at law change and how we can go about this. So it's just to flag that and dovetail my presentation. So going through the slides, if I may, I wanted to give the context, and maybe all of the speakers will give this, but this is Ireland that we're living in, certainly the last census, 2016, we're just shy of the next one. And it shows very clearly that we are not living in a society filled with married couples with or without children, which is what a family under the Constitution has been defined as in Murray versus Ireland. We have a wonderful array of family formations, ever increasing in terms of their number, cohabiting couples with and without children, same-sex couples now coming in within marriage, and I'll mention that in a moment. We have same-sex civil partnerships, although you can't undo one anymore. We have a huge number of one-parent families, and Karen will speak to that, I presume, predominantly. And as you can see, mostly mothers, 86.4% headed by mothers. And then you have children, more than one in every third child is born outside marriage, so automatically not in a constitutional family, even where you have whatever your barometer might be, but even where you have cohabiting couples very much choosing to have children and functioning as a family and a very positive contribution to society, they simply cannot be regarded as a family. And I mean, one of the key things we're talking about here is form versus function. You're recognized as a constitutional family because you have the form, you've entered into the marital ceremony without ever exploring the function that you might be contributing to society. So there is a huge presumption that by virtue of the fact of the marital ceremony, that you are that unit that contributes so significantly to our society. And without that ceremony, you're not. And that is just simply nonsense in terms of taking such a black and white approach. So looking then briefly at what the Constitution says. So Bunreacht na hÉireann, our Irish Constitution, has very expressly identified the importance of the family unit with its own provision in Article 41, which interestingly wasn't in the 1922 version, but did appear in the 1937 Constitution. And you'll see shortly that whilst it identifies the family as the fundamental unit group, it's only Article 41.3, which I will come to, that is the focus of our conversation this evening, that limits it to the marital family. And as I said, we've had legislative efforts to recognise and protect other families, but that is where it stops at the statutory level. And I know you've referenced the UN Convention definition, and also there is the European Court of Convention of Human Rights definition under Article 8, which they're much more generous and embracing definitions, but they are not binding under Irish law. We live in a dualist system, so we would need to make it part of Irish law if we wanted to. So in terms of Article 41, just for those who are watching by way of brief summation, Article 41 does identify the family as that natural and primary fundamental unit group of society, hugely important, currently a moral institution possessing inalienable and imprescriptible rights antecedent and superior to all positive laws. So positioning the family in a really superior, elevated position in Irish society, recognizing its significance. And there are many aspects that flow from that. Very importantly, following up, Article 42, identifies the primary position of the parents within that family and their sole position as the primary natural educator provider in the broadest sense, as the slide tells us. And we do know, which in a good way, that Article 42A was introduced in 2012 to identify individual rights for children who up to that point were presumed to be all consumed within the family unit. And this has gone a long way, mostly through enabling legislation to identify that families exist in different ways. And we have seen how through statute that we have parental rights arising through guardianship for non-married parents. And I'll touch on that in a moment. But even still, ultimately, it goes back to the family based on marriage. And we know this because Article 41.3, which is just there, says that the state pledges to guard with special care the institution of marriage on which the family is founded. And it's underlined because they are the crucial words. Up until 41.3, the family is wonderful, the family is elevated, will be protected. But then the family is completely restricted through 41.3 to limit it to the family based on marriage. And what that has done is that it has enabled the courts to say that the constitutional status, rights and protections afforded to the family under Article 41 can only apply to the family based on marriage to the exclusion of all others. I will briefly just show you this slide because I will never make a presentation on 41 without highlighting this, because this is the provision which further demonstrates that very traditional view of the family that was perceived in 1937 as the optimum family, including gender specific roles where the woman ought not to be forced to, and I love this, the neglect of her duties within the home. So this all speaks to the same conservative view that would have existed back in 1937 and still remains in our constitution to this day. So, before I talk about how the courts have limited family, I do want to nod to marriage equality in May 2015, phenomenally important development in Irish society to recognize the right to marry. And as wonderful as it was, and as powerful as it was and is, the consequence of it is that same-sex couples can now choose to marry, but then they come within this little fabulous bubble of protection, again, to the exclusion of all others. So it was a very important development, but it was just, again, restricting, it did nothing to 41, except thankfully include same-sex couples, but it still required the marital basis for protection. So just to recognize that it's still only married people, albeit in a good way, it recognizes same-sex married couples. So I'm not gonna give you, an hour on family law cases that have brought us to this place, but very clearly and succinctly, in McGee, we were told that a woman, a married woman, has a right to marital privacy. She is entitled to have access to contraception, but most importantly, such right to privacy is limited to persons who are party to a marriage. It was expressly stated that this judgment could have no relevance to people who were not married. And Justice Watch quite firmly said that her success was based upon the fact that she was a married woman and her sexual relations and decisions with her husband were that of a married couple. Murphy versus the Attorney General, a tax case, a married couple. Both teachers were paying more tax as a married couple than if they were being taxed as single people. Bottom line was, this was an unjustified attack on marriage. It would disincentivize marriage for people, and so therefore simply could not stand, but only married people again. And then the quite infamous case of Nicolau, the man who sought to quash adoption, the adoption order for his child. He found out about the adoption order after the fact, but he was his application was rejected on the basis that as an unmarried father, he simply lacked standing before the courts. Now, he didn't have standing under the relevant adoption legislation, but the court, looking at his rights, he tried to claim rights under Article 40, which is personal rights, and Article 41 as a family. And certainly in respect of Article 41, the court rejected his application, confirming once again that Article 41 only applies and is confined to families based on marriage. More recently, we have the case of Baby Anne, a child who was with proposed adopters for 18 months, and her natural parents, the mother sought to revoke the consent, and ultimately the decision turned on the fact that the couple who were the parents, the natural parents of the child, had married before bringing the case to the High Court, and the Supreme Court unanimously decided that once that marriage took place, they became a constitutional family with all the associated rights and presumptions, and the child would return. Now, this predated the children's referendum in 2012. So in this case, Baby Anne's voice did not have a constitutional standing. So Article 41 was the only constitutional position on the table, and Baby Anne was returned to her parents. A very complicated case, a very difficult decision to make. But in terms of Article 41, that was the decider for the courts. And then finally, just briefly to mention the MacD case, this was the sperm donor case. We had a lesbian couple in a very long-term committed relationship with custody of the child born following sperm donation. And Justice Hedigan very bravely sought to identify them as a de facto family, aligning himself with Article 8 of the European Court of Human Rights, the European Convention on Human Rights, which recognises the right to family and private life. But the Supreme Court utterly rejected the concept of a de facto family. It did not exist under Irish law and could never be regarded as a family under the Constitution. They did not accept Justice Hedigan's invitation to take a more discretionary approach and to examine the respondent's circumstances and their committed relationship. Justice Denham regarded it as an error in family law, rejected the suggestion of a de facto family, and Justice Gagan said it was simply a shorthand method of referring to the way in which they were living, but it was certainly not legal status. So we have had cases before the courts where there could have been a reinterpretation, a modern interpretation, perhaps that the family based on marriage would be specially guarded, but perhaps other families would be guarded, but it has not been accepted by the courts. In terms of what's the impact, okay, for time, in terms of the impact, it does impact significantly, obviously, on parental status and associated rights. That presumption that children are always best placed with the married family has also damaged children historically, where the state has had a higher threshold to remove a child from a family where the child may have been in danger. Just a slide in terms of each of the parents, you know, an unmarried mother, using that term. Article 40 is the basis for a mother's right to assert her right to guardianship and custody. She cannot assert that right under Article 41. And those rights are embedded then in legislation. But we also know that they are somewhat precarious when you compare to a married mother. Certainly in the case on the screen, NAHB, Justice McGuinness noted that the mother in this case, her right to veto the adoption was waived of her child on the basis of the circumstances, which were very challenging. It's very important to note that, but it was noted that in terms of Article 41, it did not apply. And so as a result, relying on Article 40, which is her rights were neither inalienable nor imprescriptible. So they were lesser than that of a married woman. Similarly, the position of the unmarried father, just briefly to say that until 1987, there wasn't even a vehicle to apply to be a guardian. After 87, you could apply to the court. Just before 2000, you could agree with the mother. And since 2015, you can have automatic status if you can adhere to the cohabitation requirements. But the courts have been very clear over the years that the blood link of a natural father with his child is only one determining factor and cannot automatically give rights. So just to mention the 2015 Act, which has sought to recognise the multiple families that exist in Ireland. And that's really important to acknowledge that. But what it did do was that it was a child-centred piece of legislation. It allowed social parents, it allowed non-biological carers to apply to the courts for guardianship. So finally, we have a vehicle for that to happen, very much focused on equalising the position of children, irrespective of the relationship of their parents or perhaps even their own biological or not, or lack of biological relationship with their primary carer. So that's really positive from a child's rights perspective. But even that hasn't been brought in without its problems. And we continue to deal with those with amendments and an amendment in 2018. So it is a legislative attempt to provide these mechanisms, but they still remain subconstitutional in terms of the hierarchy. These are not families for the purpose of the Constitution. They are legislatively facilitated guardianship and other orders that can be made to better position the child in terms of legal representation. So finally, in terms of reform, my last point was just to note that the judges in the higher courts have become more aware of the social reality within which families are living and the shortcomings of the Constitution. So IRM certainly made some noise in the Supreme Court. Ultimately, they rejected the suggestions of Justice Humphrey in the High Court, but it's important to note that Justice Humphrey did arguably suggest a judicial willingness to reconsider the Constitution's limited recognition of families in light of social change, and he expressly referenced the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights and Irish changes, including the Article 42A referendum and the marriage referendum, and just spoke about the new Ireland we're living in. Subsequently, similarly in immigration case, but ultimately in the Supreme Court, it was recognised that it will be difficult for the courts alone to make any movements on this. The final case I want to mention is really important. It's just a very tragic case from the start of the year in relation to care for a child, where the parents objected to the medical views and the Attorney General made a submission saying he regarded the possibility of a constitutional re-collaboration to provide for a more child-oriented approach to matters of constitutional interpretation. And McKechnie in the Supreme Court was quite strong. He said the supposition that getting married is the sole trigger for whether or not a family unit grouping is recognized as a family seems increasingly divorced from the social and cultural realities of many people in Ireland. And he said this unmarried family, these unmarried parents, were a group that who previously wouldn't have protection. One might very well wonder why sometimes constituting de facto families when they fulfill the same functions as the married family, why they are considered any less worthy of the protection afforded to the married family. And so he said that there are signposts definitely pointing the direction that maybe we need an alternative construction than that provided in Nicolau. However, ultimately, he said that it can't be denied that John's parents' position would be stronger, their rights somehow strengthened if they were married. You can play around with 40, 42, and 42A, but those rights cannot derive from Article 41. So my final slide just references what I believe to be an absolutely overdue pressing need for a referendum for Article 41. We need to change its provisions, and I would support what Labour are proposing this evening, but also the proposals of the Citizens Assembly just from June saying we need to amend Article 41 to protect private and family life with the protection afforded to the family not being limited to the marital family. There you go.
Brilliant. Louise, thank you so much. It's amazing what you covered there in 15 minutes. And I suppose the last two, three slides there really hit home, didn't they? Where things are at. So thank you so much. Just to say to people that are watching live, you can post questions as well on Facebook, and those questions will be fed through to us. And at the end, we're going to take questions. There's already many questions flowing in there. So thanks a million, Louise. So now we're very, very lucky as well to have Karen Kiernan with us. So Karen Kiernan has a bachelor's and master's graduate of Trinity College, and Karen has completed further studies in mediation and child and family law. So Karen previously worked as an information advocacy officer with the Irish Family Planning Association, and she was previously a board member for Dress for Success and the Health and Social Care Regulator, CURU. Karen is CEO of One Family Ireland, having worked with them for over 20 years. And Karen is a member of the chair of the Child Poverty Subgroup of the Advisory Council on the National Children's Strategy. She's also a member of the Parenting Working Group with TUSLA, the Child and Family Agency. Karen also serves as a board member and as a representative of court users with the Irish Court Service. So Karen, we're absolutely delighted to have you, and really interested to hear your speech about your work as well.
Thanks very much, and thanks for the invitation. Hopefully what I'll be talking about will build on the really excellent basis that Louise gave us to understand legally what's happening in Ireland. One Family is a service provider. We're an organisation that's been around since the 70s, and we provide a range of family support and therapeutic services to people living in one-parent families. So that's children, parents, step-parents. So if you're parenting alone, if you're sharing parenting of your children, which people increasingly are, or if you're going through the long process of separation, we may have services to help you. We also then provide the My Options service on behalf of the HSE, and we work around the area of crisis and unplanned pregnancy. But we always have tried to bring our practice learnings from families into policy and to make changes. So we also have a part-time policy function, and I, as CEO, also do a lot of policy work because we want to change things and we want to make Ireland better and not just be a service provider. But I want to go back a little bit in time to when the organization was set up by a group of what, you know, Louise said, yeah, the unmarried mothers. So these were women. It was the early 70s. There was a lot of liberation movements going on globally and in Ireland. And the women who founded Cherish, as it was known at the time, were the same organization. Didn't want their children taken from them for adoption. They were working women. They were a little bit older, in their 30s, and they wanted to raise their own children. So they bravely did that. And then they started to meet and get to know each other. They infiltrated the women's movement for good or for bad. And then an ad in the evening, the Irish press brought lots of people to the founder's house, Maura O'Dea. And she wrote about all of this in a really interesting book called Single Issue, which is still available online. And what the way the situation was then was that those women, those pregnant women, those mothers could be fired for being pregnant, could be thrown out of their homes. They had absolutely no rights and protection. Of course, at the time, illegitimacy, that wasn't abolished until the mid-80s. There was no social welfare payment. So for many women, they had no economic option other than to relinquish their children voluntarily or involuntarily, because they could not live and they could not work because they weren't allowed to. Interestingly, one of the few mothers in the civil service was one of the founders who ran the Clare Limerick branch of Cherish, because she was unmarried, she couldn't be fired because the marriage bar, she worked for Shannon Airport, but she was a mother. So it was one of those really good, anomalies. And she tells a good story on it. So, slowly change happened with the help also of Mary Robinson, who was our first president and was the president of Cherish until she became the president of Ireland. And we know the importance she had in taking cases and of bringing her name and gravitas and her learning to the issues that were just so discriminatory against children of unmarried parents and the way that unmarried mothers were treated at the time. So I suppose since then we've had a very slow process of family legislation, culminating, as Louise was explaining, in the Children and Family Relationships Act. So a lot of the difficulties that were there have been removed. So a lot of the legal problems that our founders faced, a lot of those are gone. However, we're 50 years old next year. And when I ring Maura, the founder, she'll say, "Karen, has that happened yet? Have you sorted that out? Is that referendum done?" I'm going, "Geez, Maura, no, not yet, but we're still working on it." Because she wants it done. It is hugely symbolically important to her. But at the time, you have to remember, that's how we had wholesale, internment of women and their children, mother and babies' homes in Magdalen laundries, because they had no legal rights and protection. So whilst a lot of that has been built up, Louise is absolutely right. A mother and her child is still not a constitutional family. And people find that really difficult to understand because, you know, they gave birth to this child, they grew this child, and they're not actually a family in the eyes of the Irish Constitution. So I'm just going to give a quick run through of what our organization has been doing in terms of campaigning around this issue over the last maybe 20 years. So we started looking at this in 2004 was the year of the family. The UN has designated years, and that year Ireland had the presidency of the EU. So there was a lot of events going on, and we tried to build on that to raise the issue of family diversity. And every year since then, we've held something around the 15th of May, which is the UN International Day of the Family, to try and highlight the issue of family diversity and specifically to call for the need for constitutional change. So sometimes we had mass family day kind of gatherings with 10,000 people, and sometimes we just did social media campaign depending on our capacity. But we have a website, familyday.ie. We try and raise awareness of this all the time. So an opportunity that arose in 2013 was the Constitutional Convention, because they were looking at their programme of work and we were lobbying them. We were lobbying political parties, we were lobbying the convention to see if we could get Article 41.3 on their agenda. Now, obviously, we weren't successful, but at the time we did a bit of work on this and we formed a civil society grouping called All Families Matter. And then we also came up with some proposed wording, which I'm just going to share now with you. And it's based on ECHR, which is what Louise mentioned earlier. And we're not committed to this. You know, we're not married, to use that parlance, to this. But it seems like a good way, perhaps. And this is what it could look like if we had a referendum. And we voted on alternative wording, and this was what was put into the constitution. So obviously, if this is of interest, I can share this later on. And I hope you're not hearing the gurgling, the dishwasher is working away there. So some of the reasons why we thought this was a good idea was that it doesn't take anything away from marriage. It builds and extends rights and protection. There is obviously that very strong framework of Article 8 in the European Convention on Human Rights. And just on the next slide here, how do I get to the next slide? This should be straightforward. Okay, hang on. Just give me a second. I don't know why it's not moving when I'm on the share. So I'll just go back and share it again. So we're just looking at some of the ways in which the ECHR, this is still, there we go, may be helpful. And I suppose in some ways it may not change anything very substantial automatically, which sometimes can be good in a referendum, but it may change something symbolically. And it includes some of those other types of families that Shane mentioned. And for us, it's really important that it's child-centered. Everything we do in one family, whether we're working on child poverty or we're working on family law reform, has to be about the best interests and safety of children. It's kind of the yardstick by which we do all our work. So that is what we come up with. We haven't had reason to change that yet, but we're very interested in having these conversations. So then the Citizens Assembly, let me just go in. I'm going to show you a video, actually. So at the time of All Families Matter, there was a video made. You may recognise the person in it. Can people see and hear that?
Hi there. We'll take a family ticket, please.
No.
Sure, that's 32.
Can't see it or can't hear it, Shane?
We can hear it, but we can't see it, I'm afraid.
Can't see it. Okay, hang on. Yeah, we'll go again. Okay, how's that? Can you see that screen?
Yeah, that's good. Okay. Yeah.
Great, we'll go again.
Perfect, yeah.
Hi there, we'll take a family ticket, please.
Sure, that's 30 euro, please. Actually, could I ask you to stand up against this wall, please?
Sure, yeah.
Side thought, no dad.
Sure, yes, we just want to check in. Dunphy is the name. We've booked one of the family rooms.
Ah, yes, certainly, Mr. Dunphy. If you just sign here, I'll get your key.
Okay.
I see you're not wearing any wedding ring. I presume you have some other proof of marriage?
Actually, no, we're not married.
Well, I'm afraid this room is only available to real families, and you're not a real family if you're not married, are you?
So have you got all your homework done?
Yes. And piano practice. Sometimes, yes, for me.
Great. Pass the popcorn.
Here you go.
And now we have our regular Saturday family movie, The O'Grady Bunch. Residents of 18 George's Avenue, this broadcast will not be allowed to continue at your home, as it is available to real families only, as defined by the Irish Constitution. We apologize for any inconvenience.
So hopefully you're able to see that. I mean, obviously that is a bit out of date. It was made a couple of years ago. And the person who made it is Sinead Gibney, who's now the Chief Commissioner of IREC. So she is, and her daughter was also in it. So she is very interested in this as an issue at a personal level. So I'm just...
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this.
Oh, hang on. Sorry, something random happened.
My name is Alice.
Sorry, that's that weird YouTube thing where it continues on to the next interesting video one family has on it. So because of the Citizens Assembly, which Louise mentioned, we started looking at this again. We made a submission to the Citizens Assembly about the issue of Article 41.3. We also made a submission to the Mother and Baby Homes Commission about Article 41.3. We're really delighted to see the recommendations from the Citizens Assembly. And because of that, we started to meet politicians from all different parties, including the Labour Party, to look at how we might proceed in terms of moving this on. And Fine Gael brought this forward, is my understanding, and then there was a recent Oireachtas debate, which Ivana spoke at, on the issue of the constitutional aspects of the Citizens' Assembly. And there's agreement to set up a special committee to look at this. So I think we're waiting for other committees to end to be able to bring forward a committee. So what we're hoping for in One Family is that we'll have really good members on that committee, that it will, we can get to inform the committee on relevant issues. There'll be strong cross-party support, hopefully. And we're really talking about the constitutional aspect of it, because we want the committee to develop appropriate wording for referendum, and then we would like to see that referendum happen as soon as possible. So there is momentum around this because also of the McKechnie judgment, which Louise went through. So we have a group of civil society organisations that we've brought together, and we are having our second meeting this week to kind of look at terms of reference for that group and to look at the tasks that we might take up once the committee is put in place and how we can move forward, and potentially then looking at a referendum campaign to change Article 41.3. And to be quite honest, in One Family, we don't see many practical problems anymore on the differences compared to all the other difficulties that people living in one parent families have. But it is still hugely symbolic, and we want the change to make symbolic reparation for what was done to the thousands and thousands of mothers, babies, other family members, and what we did as a country to people. So we're very much making that connection. So I'll leave it there, and hopefully that just gives you some sense of where we're coming from as an organisation. And we're really delighted that the Labour Party is looking at this. So thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks so much, Karen. And I suppose just hearing you speak there about your founding members and the efforts and time and energy that they spent over decades to bring around some very, very, I suppose, basic changes. Like, I suppose nobody underestimates how hard it might be to bring this to referendum and make a change. And yes, everybody wants a change. So I think what we are, aren't we, kind of, I suppose, riding on a crest of a wave that people before us, people in your organization and others, would have started. So thank you so much for your words there. So now our final speaker tonight is Ivana Bacik, who, if you're in the Labour Party, doesn't need an introduction. And we're absolutely delighted to have Ivana to bring in the legislative piece as well. An undergraduate of Trinity and postgrad of the London School of Economics, Ivana practices as a barrister and teaches courses in criminal law, criminology, penology, and feminist theory and law at Trinity. Ivana's research interests include criminal law and criminology, constitutional law, feminist theories in law, human rights and equality issues in law. And Ivana has been involved in a multitude of civil rights and social justice campaigns over the years, in particular around the abortion rights campaign since the 1980s. She has been a Reed Professor of Criminal Law, Criminology and Penology at Trinity College Dublin Law School since 1996, and she was made a Fellow of Trinity College Dublin in 2005. Ivana served as a Senator for the University of Dublin constituency from 2007 to 2021 and leader of the Labour Party in the Shannon from 2011 to 2021. And in July 21, we were delighted when she won a seat in the Dáil in the constituency of Dublin Bay South. So Ivana, thank you so much for joining us. Very interested to hear what you have to say.
Thanks very much, Shane, for that lovely introduction. I should say I'm no longer in practice as a barrister or teaching at Trinity. I'm on career break, but just a little too difficult to juggle everything. But certainly was involved in practice for many years and involved in a number of cases of interest to this discussion, I think. Could I just thank you very much, Shane, and Cork South Central Labour for initiating this discussion and having this panel tonight, and also to commend Ciara Kennedy and Paul Farrelly for your work, particularly Paul, I read your submission to the Citizens' Assembly on this issue. So it's great to see that you're all pushing this issue, and that I know we'll have a good debate at the party conference in November, later this month in November, on the issue too. So it's very important. And thanks also to Councillor Conor Sheehan, who's behind the scenes there running the show. It's great also to be on a panel, I should say, with Louise and Karen, both of whom I know very well. And it's always a hard act to follow you both, particularly after those great presentations. Louise, wonderful to get that overview of the case law and the legal context. And Karen, brilliant to get the activist background and the history of one family. I can't believe it's 50 years, and your thoughts on reform as well. So I'm just going to speak very briefly, Shane, on some of my own research on this, and then the political and legislative side as well. And actually, in anticipation of tonight, I looked back at a book I did 17 years ago now. You can't really see it because of this, but it's called Kicking and Screaming, Dragging Ireland into the 21st Century. And I published it, say, 17 or 18 years ago. And I did one of the chapters in it is on the definition of family and recommendations for reform. And it was interesting to me to note that despite the text that Louise has shown you from the 1937 Constitution on family, family in Ireland has actually always been, has never really conformed to that stereotype of the nuclear family based on marriage that De Valera enshrined along with his colleagues in the 1937 text. Wonderful book by Fionnuala Kennedy from 2001 called From Cottage to Creche, which sets out the reality of family life in Ireland over the centuries, and talking about how low marriage rates in Ireland were and how disproportionately high were the number of single people in Ireland throughout most of the 20th century. There's a fantastic 1954 book called The Vanishing Irish by O'Brien, who talks about Irish marriage patterns and writes about the strange enigma of a race that believes passionately in family life and yet produces more old bachelors and old maids than any race in the civilized world. So obviously it's 1950s language, but you get the picture. Largely due to patterns of farm inheritance, to economic reasons, there were very low marriage rates in Ireland traditionally. So it's deeply ironic, therefore, that our constitutional text adopted in 1937 places this enormous emphasis on the role of the family based on marriage. And it's that text which Louise showed you, which has shaped the jurisprudence and the cases. And you've seen, as Louise has shown, you know, a series of cases in which judges perhaps timidly, you know, one might say, well, were they overly timid, saying we can't do it, we can't recognise the de facto family, we can't recognise as a constitutionally protected family anything but the family based on marriage. I think judges are hidebound by that text, though. I don't think it's, you know, despite those more positive recent comments, I think it's very hard to see how a judge can step outside or recognise as a constitutionally protected family anything but a family based on marriage, because the words are so clear. And I suppose, you know, I was involved as a junior counsel in the Zappone and Gilligan case, in which we challenged the state's definition of marriage and a family at the time, as which was then confined, of course, to heterosexual marriage. And we looked at this then. And again, while marriage wasn't defined, interestingly, and that therefore we could argue that it should encompass same-sex couples, family was defined as being based on marriage. So we now have, as Louise has said, this very ironic situation where we have progressive definition of marriage, but still a very conservative definition of family in the Constitution. So following the 2015 referendum, marriage obviously encompasses same-sex couples as well as heterosexual couples, but family continues to remain based on marriage. Now, as you've heard, that no longer reflects reality, and nor did it ever really, if you look at Irish social patterns and so on. But the current reality in particular, where we have 150,000 households based on cohabiting couples, as you've heard, 75,000 of those with children, and yet none of the protections afforded by the Constitution and Article 41. And the legal fiction, therefore, that is maintained in Article 41, that's been exposed in a number of cases. And I'm thinking of the 1994 Keegan case, in which the European Court of Human Rights suggested that the Irish definition was at odds with the definition in Article 8 of the Convention on Human Rights. And I'll say a little more about that in a minute. What's the practical impact before we look at change and recommendations for change? What is the practical impact? Because I've been asked this when I've been debating this issue. Well, very clearly, there's a practical impact for many families who don't have an access right to the court, who don't have locus standi or a ground to challenge constitutional discrimination or legal discrimination against them. And I'm thinking in particular of a case that myself and Alan Kelly and others have highlighted recently. It's the very tragic case of John O'Mara, who's a widow. I say a widower. He is somebody who, a father, whose lifelong partner, Michelle Beattie, very tragically died before they were married. So they had cohabited along with so many other couples. They had children. And yet once Michelle died, he was not entitled to any survivor benefit. And clearly, you know, so defined that distinction. If he, they had been married, he would have been entitled to the to recognition by the state and support from the state. And of course, again, there's a real inconsistency here because the state does recognise cohabitation in order to deprive people of benefits. For example, single parents who are cohabiting therefore aren't entitled, and as Karen's organisation is well aware. So we see recognition of cohabitation where it deprives people or disentitles people to protections in our social protection system, and yet no recognition of family status where couples are seeking benefits or supports from the state in situations like that experienced so tragically by John. So we are fighting to ensure that there are rights for cohabiting couples in those circumstances, that they are moved into the bubble of protection that you've heard described. And, you know, in Labour, we've always been to the fore on progressive social change and on LGBT rights and women's rights. Shane mentioned abortion rights and so on. But here's where we so clearly need to see change. And I think it's no longer the case that there's any real opposition to this change. If you look back over the years, you'll see numerous recommendations for change, numerous critiques of Ireland from the UN, the CEDAW, that is the Convention to End Discrimination Against Women. And you see the, you know, a series of expert groups and other groups recommending change to this definition. So the Constitutional Review Group in 1996 recommending a broadening of the definition, and most recently then the Citizens Assembly recommending again that we move away from this narrow definition of family, that we no longer limit protection of family life to the marital family. And and that Citizens Assembly recommendation we debated in the Dáil, my new role as a TD, we debated in the Dáil just on the 20th of October, so a very short time ago, and Minister Roderick O'Gorman was very positive, as Karen has said, about charting a way forward, about seeing a momentum now for change, for finally bringing about this expansion, this more inclusive definition of family. So I suppose I just want to finish, Shane, if I may, on just, you know, how do we move now on these, on this recommendation for change that the Citizens Assembly has so clearly made? And it's part of, as Louise said, a recommendations they made also on changing the role of women and the role of mothers in the Constitution in Article 41, which again is something that has long since should have been changed and it was very outdated. But the key question I think we're at now, and this is what I was addressing in my speech to the minister, the key question is, what do we change to? So there's a clear acceptance, clear recognition of need for change. What do we change to? So could I first just mention about the role of women in the Constitution and mothers? That's very interesting and it's instructive. When we talk about, well, surely it's simple to expand the definition of family. You might say, yes, it should be just as simple as changing our outdated and sexist language on women. But as recently as 3 or 4 years ago, there was a very clear proposal made that there would be a referendum put to the people on changing the definition of women, changing the recognition of the role of women and mothers in the Constitution. And it fell down because there could be no consensus on what to replace it with. And again, if you look back, you'll see numerous different recommendations. The Citizens Assembly most recently says they want to see a recognition for care and the role of care. Hugely problematic to put in place recognition of care in a way that doesn't create a hierarchy of rights. So that are we valuing carers, for example, more than those who are cared for? What about the rights of those who are cared for when there's a conflict? We have seen so many times unforeseen consequences. I hate that phrase, by the way, it's always used to block change. But, you know, but genuinely, when you put text into the Constitution, you have to be very careful about how it may be interpreted in decades down the line, and how rights may be placed in conflict with each other. So I think personally, there is a difficulty with how we frame support for carers in such a way, and support for care in such a way that doesn't create some sort of hierarchy. I want to see the language changed, of course, to be made gender neutral, but there's a question about how we do that. So then how do we expand the definition of family? And similarly, Shane, this is where we come to what the Cork South Central Group are proposing and Paul Farrelly's recommendation of using that UN definition of family. It's infinitely preferable to the current one, let's just say that. It's much broader. However, could I just offer an observation, which is that I think the Article 8 definition Karen mentions in the European Convention, which simply says everyone has the right to respect for private and family life, is perhaps it offers potential for this broad understanding of family that isn't confined to some state-imposed parameters. And I think that's the beauty of it. It may be better than a more specific text. And again, if you look in the over, you know, historical accounts of how families have been defined in law within the UN system, for instance, there's been controversy about whether families should be confined to household, to common residence. Should it be two or more adults who are in two adults in a sexual relationship, or two adults who are connected by blood or affinity? So these are all the difficulties that different legal drafters have grappled with over the years, and different legislators have grappled with. So I offer these thoughts not by way of conclusions, but really because I think this is a great discussion to have. I think it's really important we're doing, and I really want to commend you all for doing this. And I look forward to hearing more. And also, you know, the state registered family, let's just be careful about not creating more hierarchies and more recognized groups that belong to a bubble. At the same time, we need to ensure protections, returning to the practical, for people who find themselves in the tragic position of Johnny O'Mara and his family. So I thank you very much and look forward to the debate.
Brilliant. Ivana, thanks so much for that. And you're absolutely right. In your closing pieces there, we have to look very carefully at what we're going to replace, or what we're going to insert, I suppose, instead of the current situation. And there's much debate to be had. And that's the value of tonight and other events like this as well. I'm just going to cut straight to some of the questions and points that have been posed there through Facebook, and that just to raise a few there. Anita, one person tuning in, says that she's part of a cohabiting couple with a child. If anything happened to her, her long-term partner is not entitled to a widower's pension, a bit like John O'Mara that we mentioned, is not entitled to any of her assets and is not considered to be her next of kin in the tax system. They're considered individuals. And yet in the social welfare system, in some circumstances, they are treated as a married couple. So I think that's a very kind of practical issue there as well. Okay, so question here for the panel that's come in. If such a referendum were to pass, does the panel think that there are any further blockages within the system that need to be addressed on this issue, either in tandem with a referendum or advance or post referendum? So I wonder if anybody can think about that or throw it up. And Louise, I don't know if you want to come in there as well, or is there tidying up to be done, I suppose, Louise, in other areas maybe?
Well, jeepers, I mean, to be fair, we have made a lot of progress on a lot of related issues. A lot, as Karen said, in practice, a lot of the real fundamental stumbling blocks, and most importantly, the parental child relationship, that is now very much advanced in terms of the rights of many persons to seek guardianship, where they are a carer for a child in line with the legislative requirements. But I suppose, I mean, so much will turn on what the new Article 41 would look like. I would be greatly hesitant about creating a registration type setup, but I do also recognize the challenge then that would be posed for the almost one by one individual adjudication of a family. Are you a family or are you not a family? What are our tests? Because we can't just have then we might as well remove Article 41 if every type of everything is a family, you know what I mean, without being glib. So what we need to do is, it's really about going back to the form versus function argument that I would say. But then in terms of, if you think about it practically, so if there are circumstances and there isn't a fixed rule, and it would be very hard to have very fixed rules or parameters. So then does each case have to be adjudicated, and who's doing the adjudicating, and how is that person informed? So what I would say in terms of tidying up, that it won't be as simple as inserting different words to make it broader. I am a fan of Article 8, I mentioned it in my own presentation. What we've seen in terms of that applying in the European Court of Human Rights is that the courts are adjudicating literally on a set of facts and a set of circumstances and saying, well, does this come within the Article 8 protections? And then in turn, what we see from the European Court of Human Rights is they say, well, this is our general position, but of course we allow margin of appreciation to individual member states because we must recognize the culture and everything else within the individual states. So it is multi-layered, and there will be no one fixed solution, no matter how fantastically brilliant the legislators are, Ivana and all your team, you know, that it will be hugely challenging, and there will be questions and challenges and lack of answers, you know, in certain situations. So it's just a really hard nut to crack. I think it's really important that we recognize that there is societal buy-in. There absolutely is, to remove. People don't believe it when I say to them, my students are like aghast when I tell them what the Constitution says and what it doesn't say. Like, they're ready to get up and march. But, you know, we've yet to come up with the answer. So I haven't really answered the question. What I would say to you is that there would be, you know, this is not a one fixed thing, that it's very complicated. And we need to be careful that we don't continue to exclude certain people. So it needs to be really broad, but it also needs to be capable of application. So,
I don't know, Karen, if you want to come in there on that. I mean,
I'm not a legal expert, so I'm not aware, but I don't think there's anything as obvious as the issue of children in the marriage equality referendum. You know, there doesn't seem to be anything as obvious as that. But it's really interesting, the point that the person made about, you know, people are treated as a married couple in certain circumstances and as a cohabiting one another's. And if you, to go back to that definition of women in the home that Louise had, and she shall not neglect her duties. I mean, lone parents in the social welfare code were specifically excluded under that because that question was asked, you know, by activating and making lone parents work, is that somehow against the constitution and was deemed not to be? So it is really interesting what how things can be interpreted by people in different circumstances. So there's lots of those anomalies. I suppose if we can get very global wording, because we think a lot, it is mostly symbolic. I'm not sure, other than very specific cases, I'm not sure how many cases there will be, because the big things should really be cleared up. And the big differences are married versus unmarried families. And presumably what we are looking for is that unmarried families enjoy the same rights and protections as married families. So there'd have to be some benchmark, no more than the guardianship piece you had, Louise, around there's currently automatic guardianship after 12 months. You know, there may need to be some kind of benchmark, and we play with that. I'm not sure how it's done in other countries, because I'm not sure the countries define their families in the constitution, therefore exclude people. So I'll leave it at that, because I'm not a legal expert, and I think it would be much more relevant for the others to comment.
Yeah, I don't know, Vanna, if you want to come in there, just thought on that.
Well, very briefly, I mean, it is very problematic. And now, you know, actually, none of us mentioned the divorce referendum. I was just thinking the divorce referendum, of course, in 95 really did fundamentally change our understanding of marriage. So you could say we've changed the definition of marriage twice, once with divorce and once with the marriage equality referendum in 2015. There is a difficulty about how you replace the definition of family. Do you replace it with a broadly encompassing term? And then, as Louise says, you have the difficulty that it's a case by case, or do you have do you use definitions that will inevitably exclude some groups that may wish to identify as a family? So that's the real problem. I think in terms of practical legislation and gaps, the very clear gap remains the lack of legislation on assisted human reproduction and surrogacy, which we're currently grappling with, actually, and which this government has promised to bring in. We tried, actually, I was on the Justice Committee some years ago in the debates around the Child and Family Relationships Bill. That was supposed to be a bill that would also regulate surrogacy. And again, it just became too challenging to come up with legislative provisions that wouldn't facilitate exploitation. Or, you know, it was a real, real problem. It's a very difficult area to legislate for. And yet again, we're failing families currently by not legislating for this.
Yeah. And I think it's a real, I suppose, paradigm shift as well. I know when Paul first brought this to us, I think we all kind of were caught in this binary notion of marriage, family. And even sometimes we found ourselves tripping over, we're looking to redefine marriage. We're not, you know. And I think it's what you guys spoke about too, Ivana. I suppose for so many of us, we don't realize it, but family, it was rooted in an economic situation, you know, in terms of inheritance in Ireland, in terms of rural life and farming and everything else, you know. So moving to something broader, I think is scary for some people, but it doesn't need to be. And I suppose it's something for the future. Like, one of our thoughts, I suppose, is that, let's say, surrogacy legislation that probably deserves its own legislation. You know, I'm not sure that this can cover all gamut of situations. I don't know what people think of that as well, or where do we
have to... Shane, I just come in there and just say that, I suppose, another thought is, if you just delete Article 41. There is no Article 41. Mm. And what we do then is, I think we really need to remember what the legislature has succeeded in doing alongside Article 41. So notwithstanding Article 41 and a unique position of the married family, we have managed to develop a whole body of legislation, which, you know, when I started teaching over 20 years ago, you know, there was no cohabitation, there was no civil partnership. You know, a father couldn't automatically be a guardian. In fact, that only happened a couple of years ago. I mean, the landscape, I can't use the same family law notes every year, sadly. They have to change every September because, there are fundamental shifts all the time, our movements towards it all the time. So I think we do need to recognize that the legislature is really powerful in terms of creating and recognizing status for so many different forms of families, and I've done it really well. My biggest problem is that they still are all subservient to the, you know, all hailing Article 41. And so it's fine. I think it's wonderful. Article 41.1 is lovely. Article 41.2 is lovely. The pledge to respect and in their authority and their constitution, the family, that's all great. Take out 41.3. It's wonderful that we recognize families and families in all their shapes and forms. So it's 41.3 is the limiting, like, you know, that's the strangle around the neck piece, the 41.3. And what we've managed to do actually is to create all those categories that Ivana just mentioned. And we've done it very successfully. Now, there are criticisms about imposing cohabitation obligations and there, you know, other criticisms about the 163 differences between civil partnership as it then was and marriage, you know, and it was Article 41.3 required those weaknesses so that there wouldn't be seen to be challenging marriage or in competition with marriage. But I do think that we need to remember the power of the legislature and the capacity of the legislature to move and respond to social change in a way that the constitution simply can't. And so, you know, it is 41.1 and 41.2 are great, you know, maybe a bit gushy for my liking, but great. 41.3 is the problem. And I think we need to nod to the legislature and say, you're doing a good job, keep going a bit more, and maybe we just do need to have lots of pockets recognizing lots of families, and it speaks to the function, not the form. So do mind the wedding rings, what's that family unit doing? You know, are they, you know, supporting each other? Are they, you know, are they positive contribution in the broad sense? And then we need to work with that family to continue to be strong and positive insofar as they can, not all things being equal. So I think that that's really important as part of the debate, that the role of the legislature to be very proactive and responsive, which is what they can be.
Thanks for that, Louise. Could I just throw Shane, one other comment actually that we've been discussing a lot, and Rebecca Moynihan, my colleague in Labour, has been to the fore in talking about that family is, can itself exclude, and just not to forget that, especially in context of what I said earlier about our traditionally high level of single person households, that now single person households are really increasing number of households in if you look at census data, and are not included in family and yet are included and yet our households. So there is also that question of, should we move away altogether from family? Maybe this is too, you know, this goes beyond perhaps the scope of tonight, but, you know, is family itself the right unit of society that the Constitution of 1937 recognized? But should we in fact, you know, should we in fact rethink that now altogether? I just put that out there too, because we are again talking about this monastery ourselves.
Yeah, perfect. So I'm very conscious of time as well, and I suppose that there's been a number of questions coming in, very similar, I suppose, points that have been kind of have raised by ourselves there. I suppose, do you have any concluding remarks that you want to kind of finish up on just before we kind of conclude? I don't know, Karen, if you want to come in there.
The only other thing that I might mention, I think the mention of divorce is really interesting, and the fact that we had to go back and change that, and it's still a dog's dinner. It's still way too long. It's still too hard for people to get out of marriage, frankly, in Ireland. But the other thing is, like 10 years ago, I would have spent a good bit of my time debating the merits or demerits of married families versus unmarried families versus, you know, single parent families with the conservative right wing in Ireland. And that has changed. And I think that's changed for a couple of reasons. One is abortion, I think, has changed that. And I think the other reason is that we now have longitudinal evidence in Ireland, which shows that one parent families and cohabiting families, the barriers to their children doing as well as others are structural, and they're poverty related. They're not to do with inherently something wrong. So we now have evidence. So I think it's also interesting to think about what other social changes have happened that, you know, we're not listening to that anymore. It's not even an issue. We don't have those things coming out, which is good. So I think that it's indicative of the change and that people are ready. I think the trick is, what are you asking people? Why do you need it? You know, why do you need it? Because if people, you know, why can't someone just get married? You know, and you know, there could be very good reasons why they can't. So that is why we think about the symbolic nature of this and how important it is for symbolic reparation, because people can kind of relate to that, but also those important questions of what do you put in instead and what are you setting up. And that just, and I think a committee could be really helpful in teasing that through and helping us all get to the right point, like we saw with other difficult issues such as abortion.
Absolutely, yeah, brilliant. And Louise, do you want to have maybe concluding remarks? Or
I agree with what Karen said. I think that the more voices that can become part of this debate and the more that can inform the debate, I think that's really positive. I also heard a very interesting interview on the radio the other day, and it was about the power of stories, and it brought me back to the marriage equality referendum and repeal the eighth, and it was the power of stories that got people to sit up and realize this is a real thing, you know. And there is the sense of, so if 50% of the census are married people with children, you know, it doesn't impact people, but it impacts people when they hear about other people's pain or deprivation or suffering as a result. So that would be my little bit of advice that I'm stealing from that nice man, whoever he was, I heard on the radio. He's on the business show, and he was talking from a business perspective about how you succeed in business. He said, don't have a PowerPoint slide, have a story. And I was doing my PowerPoint today going, you know, that's really good advice. But I'm passing it on to you, because I think that to make this heard and to make it to resonate with people, to drive for change, I think, I mean, that very sad story. And I was reading about that in the Irish Times a couple of weeks ago. In fact, one of my students brought it to my attention. And she was so struck by it because of the debates we've been having in class. And I think that's where you will get support and buy-in, and people will really see the need for it.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. And Ivana, do you want to have a few concluding?
Well, thanks very much, Shane, and thanks to everyone who tuned in. And just to say, it's been a really stimulating discussion. I think it shows the importance of a process to bring about change. We saw it with marriage equality and with Repeal the Eighth, the value of having those processes of citizens' assemblies and then, you know, informed and evidence-based referendum campaigns where stories, personal stories and personal narratives were really important. So I think that's what we need here as well. And I think this is a really important, stage that we're at now, where we're embarking on this, where the political climate has changed so utterly, as Karen has said, and where, you know, we're now, there's now really no political opposition, and it's more just the difficulty logistically of how we go about the change, that's the challenge, you know. And we've been to the fore in Labour, as I've said, and I was thinking of Mervyn Taylor as we were talking about divorce, and, you know, Mary Robinson, who led on so many of those cases like McGee. And again, you know, we have made a huge change and huge strides, and we have brought our law really up to date with people's lived realities in so many ways. So this is just one more way we need to do it, and I think we'll do it. But yeah, this debate has been really useful in getting us there, so thank you.
Absolutely. So I suppose the recording part of this presentation will be over shortly, but I just want to thank again Professor Louise Crowley, Karen Kiernan and Ivana Bacik for their time and sharing their invaluable views and perspectives with us. And I suppose we've learned so much, I suppose, that I hope can take the proposal forward, because at the end of the day, if we're involved in politics, especially in the Labour Party, you want something to happen. You don't just want circular discussion that goes nowhere, even though I know these things take a lot of time as well. So I just want to, I suppose, thank again Paul Farrelly for his work on the issue, and Kira Kennedy and members of Cork Central Executive, and Jack O'Connor, Alan Kelly, and the head office support from Billy Sparks, Clodagh Bergen in the press office, and Conor Sheehan in the background organising all this. I suppose just to acknowledge as well a member of ours in South Central who passed away yesterday, Finbar Cregan, in his 80s. Finbar was a stalwart in the party, and we all, I suppose, remember him sitting in his seat in the office in Bandon Road. And if we could have meetings in person, Finbar would be there listening and giving his comments. So our thoughts are with him and his family as well this evening. But I hope this is the start of a discussion, not be an end of it. So thanks very much to all those at home. Good night and take care.